Hello dear people, the Matrixers are here again. Yes. Today again with the attractive Shiva and the wonderful Jonathan. Yes. Our topic today is a very controversial topic, and that is spiritual nourishment. I know you've asked us about it 1,000 times, and it was actually our very first video that we started, but we thought it sucked so much that we just left it and started with the light trap. But now it is. Because I think it's a very important topic. And today, we want to tell you what spiritual forms of nutrition there are, what experiences we have had with the respective forms of nutrition, and some other exciting things that we are not going to reveal just yet. Have fun. Yes, let's get started then. I would say, yes, exactly. Let's start with spiritual nutrition. With different forms of nutrition. With which diet you can reach which goal faster, and which diet is best for one or the other. Nutrition that supports health, and nutrition that supports spirituality. Yes, then I would say, let's start with the forms of nutrition, right? Yes, exactly. What is it? So, vegan. The vegan diet, right. Then there is the vegetarian diet, special alkaline diet, ovo-lacto-vegetarian, the raw food diet, raw food. Yes, exactly. And yes, these are actually the most common and normal meat-eating variation diets. And the forms of nutrition that the food industry prefers to see. Everything that the market offers, and not fresh, but beautifully prepared, with a lot of histamine. Okay, yes, exactly. So that's the diet. Then there is the histamine-free diet. Exactly, of course that too. The fructose-free diet. The fluoride-free diet. So there's a lot of diets out there. The paleo diet, and yes, of course we have tried a lot, from completely normal, as prescribed by the food industry, to raw food, histamine-free, fluoride-free, alkaline, vegan, vegetarian. Tried everything, tested everything. And yes, I would say, tell me, what is your favorite? Well, I used to eat a vegetarian diet for a long time, but then occasionally ate fish or eggs. So I was an ovo-lacto-vegetarian for many years, and then I tried the alkaline diet. And the alkaline diet for me actually consisted only of salad, vegetables, potatoes, and occasionally chicken. I did that for many, many years. Then I gave up meat for a while. Really, I only ate vegetables, potatoes, and salad every day, and I have to say that I lost a lot of the squeamish, i.e., the little squeamishes that one has so physically, so sometimes. Here you pick, there you pick. Not happy with the weight. Health wasn't the best. And that all disappeared during this time when I was eating so alkaline. And I have to say that this is my favorite too, the alkaline diet. You can really whip your whole body back into shape. Afterwards, I could walk to the fourth or fifth floor, or, so to speak, run without being out of breath. And without having explicitly done any sport. Yes, without having done any sport. I could run, I could walk, I could climb stairs without getting tired at all. And I lost a lot of weight there too. Which I also found very good at the time, because I had a bit more on my ribs. And I have to say that it really was the best form of nutrition for me. And with you? How was that for you? What was the best for you? The best for me was, of course, I tried everything possible, from vegan to vegetarian. But I found the best energetically and physically, I found raw food. Raw food. Ah yes, so really great too. Pure raw food. At first I was missing something like my bread or something. Not meat at all. But there are also different ways to make your own bread when it comes to raw food. Raw food bread and dehydrators and stuff that has no wheat in it, so no gluten, no nothing really from pure raw food. And yes, I got by with that for a long time, I really liked it. Unfortunately, I didn't get through it to the end somehow, didn't follow through with it any further. So after 6 months, 3/4 of a year I switched back to vegan, vegetarian again and so on, but only raw was very hard. But then you also had good experiences, that is, spiritual ones, at that time. Of course, pure raw food really boosted the energy. I could practically see with the ornamental gland, with my eyes open, just like that, I could practically see the aliens in front of me, who came or made contact and that was very exciting because the energy increased. You always felt happy in it, peace with yourself, and you were always in the here and now. And yes, through the diet, through the raw food diet, a lot has happened without having to be spiritually active in any way, I would say. You know what I mean? Without meditating now or spiritually, no idea wanting, needing to educate, no idea, it just happened, it was just there, just by this diet. Yes, that was the case with me too, when I was eating purely alkaline for many years, so I didn't need to meditate anymore. The dreams came by themselves, the out-of-body experiences came by themselves. So you didn't have to do anything anymore. All I had to do was go to bed and the cool experiences and stuff started right away. Definitely. And also, as you say, the pineal gland also reacted very positively to it. I then also perceived things in everyday life, sometimes perceived the deceased or some beings and the like. Well, and in a very gentle way, which then somehow, yes, that was all the way it was, as well as insights or things that one saw with the pineal gland and such. They came in very smoothly and not so plop, not so shocking or in a way that scared you a bit or something. So that was, I have to say, the best form of nutrition for me. For you, the raw food. I would also say that these are the two best forms of nutrition. Not only for those who would like to be physically healthy again, but also for those who want to work on their pineal gland. And also those who just want to work on themselves spiritually and also want to develop skills. Yes, what you should of course still say about raw food and alkaline nutrition is that of course there are also the forms of nutrition. If you simply only use the raw food for 30 days and someone has diabetes, then the diabetes is history afterwards. For example, because then you is so basic that nothing else can survive. The body practically recovers by itself, just through these forms of nutrition. It was then with every illness. Well, afterwards I felt so light physically, so good and energized and fit and all sorts of things. But well, of course I also detoxified by the way, I think you did too. Yes, we'll get to that later and decalcify whatever is possible. So I really nailed it and I think you did too. Exactly. In theory, my favorite would be to eat like the creatures of nature. Ah, nature beings. Yes, that's one. Very special diet. You can really live to be 200 years old with that if you keep doing it your whole life. Yes, then explain to me how the nature beings feed safely. Do you know that? The nature beings practically only feed on fruit that pleases, or rather, on fallen fruit, to be precise. They don't pick anything from the trees, they take what nature gives. And that's what they feed on. So they don't take an apple that's still hanging happily on the tree, but only when the apple has fallen and says, so to speak, I'm ripe. Eat me. Yes. Didn't you once say that in a higher state of consciousness you saw it too? I found the fruit very funny. Tell me, I had to laugh so hard, so I kind of sat there with a friend in the kitchen and we talked and stuff. And somehow suddenly I got into a higher state of consciousness and my gaze happened to fall on a fruit bowl in which there were pears, apples, bananas and grapes. And that was incredible. I could feel the fruit in that bowl in that moment and one continued to focus on the fruit. And then I could feel the fruit talking. The fruit always said, eat me, eat me, eat me. So it was phenomenal that the fruit somehow saw it as a calling to be eaten. And that was really amazing for me. And as you say, the nature beings feed themselves mainly on fruit that has just fallen from the trees. Anything you can pick. For example, they wouldn't necessarily eat something that had to be pulled out of the ground, like salads or cabbage or something. You have to rip that out of the ground. Then the whole plant dies. So the natural beings don't go there. They really only go for the fruit or the vegetables, like tomatoes, for example, whatever just falls or falls off. What is given, so to speak? Yes, what is given by nature. And then they hold their hand over it and pull the essence of life out of the fruit or tree. Out of the fruit. And they really only live on food that has this essence of life. Because of that, they don't eat meat, they don't eat carcasses, it's dead tissue for them, they're really alive, they couldn't pull any life essence out of it either. Yes, meat is dead. That's already dead. There's nothing left in the essence of life. That's why the natural beings would immediately refuse and say no, no, there's no life essence in it, we don't want it. Doesn't help either. You can't eat anything else. Yes, they put their hand over it and pull out the life essence. And why would you put your hand over it and pull out the essence when there's nothing inside? That actually shows a bit in which direction you should eat. Theoretically. Yes. That would of course be an interesting goal, but it is very difficult for humans. Especially in today's society with all the delicacies that exist and such. Yes, our recommendation would be, if meat is eaten, then preferably chicken, two-legged. Bipeds only, no quadruped. They have a slightly higher frequency than the four-legged friends. And a little more basic. White meat is slightly more basic. So, if you don't manage to switch to vegetarian or vegan, which is really not absolutely necessary, as you will find out later. But if you want to go this route, you shouldn't force yourself to go vegan first. And you can only do that for a maximum of 2 months anyway, and then that's it. Because this is an inner process that you go through and therefore don't force yourself into anything. Start slow, step by step. If your goal is to eat higher frequency, maybe just leave something out here or something there. Or do you take more apples? Or start switching from beef to chicken. So very slowly. And if it takes a year, then it takes a year. Better than stopping after a month. Then, of course, there is the conflict between vegans and meat eaters. It's really bad that they're constantly arguing and the like. And I can only say that if you, as a vegan, Try by all means to convince a meat eater that he should stop. Maybe attack him, be hostile to him, or even hate him. Then that is just a projection of his own doubts. That is, the vegan himself has doubts that he will be a vegan for the rest of his life. And these doubts are then projected onto a person who is representative of their doubts. And that's the power behind it. Why some vegans are hostile to meat eaters. And of course, I would like to say that you should gradually change your diet. As Shiva says, not with a tag, so boom. As of today, I'm vegan or something. Everyone has their own speed, and you should have understanding for that and not put pressure on someone, because that creates polarization again. Because the meat eater then thinks afterwards, the vegans are all in such a bad mood. I will never become vegan. So don't judge or condemn too quickly. Just let it go. And I came up with another good example. In this reality, you may be a vegan. But what about the alternate reality next to it? There you may be a meat eater, because not in all realities that are possible you are a vegan. Yes. So to speak. It's like smoking. You may choose to quit smoking in this reality. However, that doesn't mean that all of the personalities that exist in alternate realities quit smoking right away. It doesn't necessarily mean that. And so it is with nutrition. So switch gradually, not all at once. I appeal more to compassion and understanding from both sides. Because no one has gone the way of one or the other. And everyone just stands where he is. And that's why the next step might be a completely different one, in a completely different direction. Extremism somehow never leads to anything. No, no. And yes, I also know people who eat meat. They drink alcohol every day, they smoke weed and travel almost astrally every night. How can that be? That's when you realize that somewhere, something hasn't been fully understood, that things like that can really happen. There are also people who have stopped smoking, stopped drinking alcohol, etc. And then came the experience. So it doesn't have to be the case for everyone that a basic diet or a vegan diet is 100% synonymous. That something changes 100% doesn't have to be the case. No, but why might that be? Because we are in the matrix. And we live in a simulation. A computer simulation that was programmed. This means that no matter what you eat, you are actually only eating a program. Everything is really just zeros and ones. Basically, you're not eating a real animal, you're eating a zero and a one, if you look at it that closely. The problem is your own beliefs that you have, and accordingly, it will of course have the same effect on you. What you believe will happen. If you believe that if I eat beef and meat, I can still experience out-of-body experience, etc. Then that will probably be the case. In terms of frequency, of course, fruit and vegetables vibrate much higher, which is probably why nature beings feed themselves that way. And that's why it is, of course, also much more beneficial for spiritual development. But in the end, a lot depends on beliefs. In theory, you can eat anything you want, meat, chips, chocolate. And that shouldn't really matter, because everything is just a program and a simulation. All other beliefs. Yes, yes, that's correct. It's all beliefs, of course. But you can, because I'm already hearing some people saying, oh yes, if you can eat everything, what is the video for now? Why is nutrition talked about? You can all take me there. Since I eat what I want, it's all just a belief. Yes, But nature doesn't make it that easy for us. Because if you can handle drinking a bottle of Domestos on X without dying or getting a stomach ache, then you are 100% in control of your beliefs. And please don't try it. No, we don't want to say that here. Theory only. We've got some really great examples today, you know? And that's why it's better to eat healthily. We can also take a more harmless example. For example, you can take a high dose of LSD. And if it's completely harmless, and if that doesn't do anything for you or something, then you can say, yes, I have my beliefs under control. And for the reason that what we eat already has a certain effect because of the collective consciousness. Because the whole collective, that is, the consciousness, the common consciousness of all people, is already having an effect on us. Because it is difficult to see through all beliefs, so you can. It should also be the goal, but if you haven't traveled far yet, you should probably skip the Domestos and the LSD. Correct. Exactly. And that's why, before you overestimate yourself, you should consider whether you can change your diet. This is the easier way. Because if you are already suffering from any physical problems, for example, from certain allergies or from certain other physical problems that exist, then a change in diet, the right diet, will ensure that you are in top shape again within weeks or months at the latest. That's the way it is. Yes, top fit, and the illnesses will then be gone. Personally, I assume that 99% of all diseases are food-related. 99%. So if you change your diet, you can say that 99 out of 100 people will be fit and healthy again. No matter what the doctor said when he said, yes, you have Hashimoto, it's incurable. Then you can still get everything under control with your diet, including other diseases. Yes, we talked a lot about nutrition. We had extensive discussions and tested without end. And tested without end. And yes, we noticed something funny. Because the beef that is slaughtered is not at all the beef that is on your plate, even if you don't even know when the beef is slaughtered in front of you. Yes, does anyone understand that now? I thought I'd explain it in short and you in pretty. Yes, seen from a higher perspective, that is, from someone who is not incarnated, who looks down on us on a higher level of existence, so to speak, who would recognize that we have a very specific perception of, time due to our upbringing. For example, you first have to be 18 years old, then you have to get your driver's license, then you have to buy a car, and then you can drive a car. From a higher perspective, however, this sequence is actually nonsense, since all existences and all sequences of experiences exist at the same time. So it would be quite possible, seen from a higher perspective, to first drive a car and then get a driver's license. But do they understand that now? Yes. And that means that our perception of time is taught in a certain continuity by our parents, by society, by teachers, etc. But we don't have to perceive this time like this. But we are programmed that way and therefore perceive it that way. And that's also what Shiva says, that the piece of beef that you may have had on your plate yesterday has nothing to do with a piece of beef in the meadow. Just as, for example, a seed has nothing to do with the flower that is on your balcony. Because these are different sequences of experiences that our trained time perception perceives in this order. That That's not supposed to be an excuse for the meat eaters, of course not. Just as it shouldn't be an excuse to say that the person who was shot has nothing to do with who is lying dead on the ground afterwards. Of course it is. But that doesn't mean that you should go around and shoot other people. But it just means that you can understand the perspective from a higher level. Because in this life we might be vegetarians, and in another life we ate a pig every day, so or in an alternate reality. In this reality we might be a vegetarian or vegan farmer who even grows his own food, and in another sub-reality we work in the slaughterhouse. So the possibilities are very broad, and that's why you shouldn't look at the whole topic in such a dualistic or polarizing way. Everything just builds on each other in a certain time sequence. Just like we were taught. But I don't know if one or the other understood that. At least we told you about it. Anyway, we told you about it. You could think about it philosophically. In any case, we philosophized about it and thought, what we find out, you may also know. It's like in the film here, The Matrix. When Cypher was sitting at the table with the agent in the restaurant, he cut off a piece of steak, held the steak up like that and said, I know it's all just numbers and numbers what this piece of steak is made of, but it tastes delicious. And I also remember a discussion I had with my spirit helper Sonia. Ah, the tomato. Yes. She showed me a tomato and an apple and then said to me, many years ago, Jonathan, what is the difference between this tomato and this apple? And then I said, yes, a tomato here is a vegetable and an apple is a fruit. And she like this, paparlapop, how come? Why then? What, paparlapop, there is no difference. And at the time I didn't understand what my spirit helper actually wanted to tell me. Today I don't know earlier. Yeah. We leave the mystery open. No, that's settled. Halfway, I hope. Yes. Then now to our diets. Specifically, I would say. Yeah, a bit more concrete about alkaline nutrition. Basically, raw food should be clear. So our favorites. Let's explain our favorites in a little more detail. Yeah, I think raw food is pretty clear. You are raw, meaning you take the apple and bite into it, or the tomato. Point. I also like to make it in smoothies. It's for those who like to mix things up. Green smoothies are not quite as popular, but they are particularly healthy. On the next smoothie, we will come to detox. Of course you can also dry a lot, but not at more than 40 degrees, because otherwise the protein will denature and then it is no longer raw food. So you can still dehydrate up to 40 degrees and still have your fresh raw food with all its vitamins. With a blender, like this, you should make sure that it is a high-performance blender so that the cells of the fruit and vegetables are broken down and all the minerals and vitamins are released. And can also be consumed. Because if you're the apple like that, you'll never be able to break down the cell walls well enough to absorb all those important minerals and trace elements. That's why a high-performance mixer is not bad at all. And what I can also recommend is a juicer for raw vegetables, and not just any juicer, but a slow juicer. This is still practical, since the fruit or vegetables are ground practically mechanically and you have an extremely high yield of vitamins, trace elements and also juice. And that means it's the healthiest, best juice you can imagine. So high performance mixer and slow juicer. Yes, dehydrator and the raw food diet can start. Of course, you can also keep it simple and just eat fruit and vegetables. Yes, that's right. So with raw food, there is of course a lot that you can do. You can make raw mayonnaise, raw bread, raw pizza, raw pasta, spaghetti. You can really do almost anything with raw food that you can do with a regular diet. It doesn't taste quite as good, but it actually tastes very, very good, I have to say. I've also made raw food pies. They're really awesome, but in the end, I think I just went about keeping it as simple as possible. Because life is complicated enough, not mine, but in general, and the simpler, the better, simple. Yes, so it's more for those who like to do handicrafts or cook for themselves or try something out. And who sometimes lack something like bread or something. There is really fantastic raw food bread that tastes almost even better than real bread. But for those who like it simple, fruit and vegetables. Yes, the alkaline diet. Yes, the basic diet I recommend is not just basic, but also the histamine-free and fluoride-free diet. So a combination of these three topics, I would say. Always fluoride-free anyway, regardless of the diet. Correct. Fluoride-free is very important. Fluoride is found in some waters, often in salt and of course in our toothpaste. Therefore, make sure that you use low fluoride or lives fluoride-free and then always takes a close look at the water. How much fluoride is in it? How much fluoride is in my toothpaste? How much fluoride is in a salt, etc. That you look at it and try to omit the elements that contain fluoride. That's step one. Step two is histamine-free. For those who have an intolerance anyway. No, at all. Well, we're still arguing about that. So histamine-free because histamine always comes together with tyramine, which means that if you have consumed a lot of histamine, you automatically have tyramine in your blood and the pineal gland produces yes DMT molecules. And funnily enough, the DMT molecules produced by the pineal gland are also released into the blood and tyramine, and DMT molecules do not get along. As soon as they collide, the tyramine breaks down the DMT molecule. That's why it's so important to follow a certain diet if you want to do an ayahuasca session. You should avoid certain foods. And when you look at these foods to avoid before the ayahuasca session begins, all foods that are high in histamines is an odd coincidence, isn't it? And that's why histamine-free means that certain nutritional elements have to be left out. This includes. So there is a distinction between natural histamine and formed histamine. And the histamine that is formed is the histamine that you should primarily avoid. For example, you made a meal for yourself at lunchtime and you didn't eat everything. Then put it somewhere with the lid on it and think to yourself, I'll eat that again tonight. And in those 6-7 hours that it's sitting there, histamines build up in the food. So that means you shouldn't reheat what you've eaten for lunch in the evening because it then contains too much histamine. Also, many processed foods often have histamines. Some powdered things, for example. Anything that has been preserved in cans or things that are also offered with a pizza or that has just been lying around in the front of the display case in the subway for hours. Or fish, especially fish that has just been lying around somewhere for hours, forms an incredible amount of histamine. And then you just have to ask yourself what or which foods you should avoid. You have a list, don't you? On Matrix, there is a list for histamine-free or alkaline diets. Correct. Exactly. And the histamine-free diet is a bit complicated because a lot of things are omitted, but the bottom line is that you end up back where I started. In the end, it stays that way that you eat mainly vegetables, salad and potatoes. And if you want, you can eat a little chicken or maybe fish with it. But when it comes to fish, it must be very, very fresh, and it must be sea fish, not sea fish. Yes, and you can maybe take a look around on my blog. There are food lists at the top of the menu and you can see which diet suits you. And that's exactly what my favorite is based on. Namely histamine-free, fluoride-free and base. I am also alkaline and fluoride-free. I'm not quite into histamine-free yet, at least all processed foods, chocolate and stuff like that. But there are also some fruits and vegetables that also have histamine. But mostly they are liberators, which means that if you have consumed histamine, it still supports the fruit and vegetables. If you haven't ingested histamine, then nothing happens. For example, tomatoes are liberators, which means that if you haven't ingested histamine before, you can eat a tomato with a clear conscience. Of course, there are also fruits and vegetables that contain histamine. You mean like grapes? Wine and alcohol. But let's talk about the grapes. Yes, I would still lean towards the natural beings and say that the natural beings would not despise the grapes either. Because if it gets that, then nature will know what she's doing. And so I would say grapes are okay. But those who really want to do without histamine must of course do without grapes. Yes, but nature beings also eat histamine-free food. And they don't eat grapes? They don't eat, they only draw the essence of life. Okay, yes, so we're not sure about histamine-free, that's perfectly fine. But the basic thing is clear, basic, fluoride-free, high-frequency nutrition, as possible. And with that you are already on a good spiritual path to increase your energy in your body, to make your body healthy again. Yes, and now the detoxification follows to bring the body back into shape. Of course there are many detoxifications. Colon cleansing is very important and of course heavy metal elimination is also very important. And if you haven't eaten quite so healthily over the years, it's also recommended to detoxify yourself and slowly go in the direction of spiritual nutrition or something. At least a little healthier. And yes, I am currently doing a detox based on a recommendation. I've done a lot of detoxification as well as fasting cures, but what I'm currently doing is really, really recommendable, because it really knocks out all the heavy metals I've absorbed over the years like mercury, because I had amalgam fillings. And all other heavy metals are eliminated with it, too, with Anthony Williams's Heavy Metal Detox Smoothie, which I'm currently making. It's really great and I also notice that I'm really detoxifying. The detox smoothie is actually quite easy to make. You actually only take 200 grams of blueberries, wild blueberries, can also be frozen, one banana or two bananas, depending on how it tastes. Three large oranges, freshly squeezed or freshly squeezed orange juice, whichever you choose. So a cup of fresh orange juice. Then you take a teaspoon of Hawaiian spirulina powder. Then dulse seaweed a handful, Atlantic dulse. Can you do everything? We'll go in below. You can order there if you want or find somewhere. Then you take a teaspoon of barley grass juice. powder and fresh coriander as very important. This also pulls the heavy metals out of the brain, even crossing the blood-brain barrier. So a big cup of cilantro isn't for everyone. I've come to love cilantro, but most people can't take it very well. And then they might start with the straw and then increase. But in the end it would have to be a lot. You mix everything really well in a blender and then enjoy this delicious smoothie. Well, it tastes very good to me, and what I'm still doing at the moment is celery juice. It's not the best of the best of the best, but it really helps a lot. Also helps with constipation or for detoxification. So you can, I don't have to tell everything now. Can you inform yourself about this? Celery juice. Fresh celery juice in the morning also helps a lot in detoxification and cleansing up in the body. Exactly. Yes, very good. The heavy metal detox smoothie. Aha. Okay. Sounds really. Yes. What I can also recommend is drinking a fresh lemon in the morning. Makes the body basic and you don't like it at all. Believe. Can't believe it. Lemon, sour, should be basic. That's interesting. And hydrates the body wonderfully. So I always feel reborn after the lemon juice. And do you know what the best remedy of all? If you ask how should I do something, you always say with dissociation. Do you know what the equivalent in nutrition is? Baking soda, yes. That's correct. The questions can always be answered with dissociation or baking soda. Dissociation for the mind, baking soda for the body, or baking soda for anything else. So baking soda is really the miracle cure par excellence. I don't know who invented this in the Matrix, but well done. Yes, you can use that on anything, soda. Also for detox, everything. For detoxification, it makes the body alkaline. If you treat yourself to half a sachet of soda, your body will immediately switch to alkaline. Of course, those of you who have eaten too acidic for a long time may run to the toilet first. It can happen. But baking soda is actually an ingenious remedy that can eliminate small illnesses and ailments, and also major illnesses that people talk about. Even cancer, it is said. To be able to conquer. You can also brush your teeth with it, wash your hair with it, make your skin more beautiful. So baking soda is just the magic bullet for practically everything. You can go swimming with it, makes the body and skin alkaline. Detox him at the same time. So, baking soda is awesome, so definitely. What other dietary supplements are there that would support this? Well, I also liked making zeebent, a mixture of zeolite and bentonite. In any case, can we sing a song by, of course, that also supports, it absorbs all the toxins and is then transported away, just like an enteros gel. Invented by the Russians, very good. It is silicon-based and is also a very powerful detoxifier. Yes, and also eliminates heavy metals. Also eliminates all rain down from heaven. With chemtrails and such, it helps a lot. So if you live in an area where there are many chemtrails, enteros gel is a good choice. Yes, you should be eating a tablespoon every day, right? 15 grams at least on an empty stomach. And do not eat anything before or after. Actually also applies to zeolite and zeebent or to my heavy metal detox smoothie or to the barley grass juice. So for most of it applies on an empty stomach or at least 1 to 2 hours in between. What else do we have? Yeah, what's the name of the little green pills we have there as well? Spirulina. No, that's not what I meant. The others, chlorella. But spirulina and chlorella, right. Exactly. So, the spirulina are the bluish ones and the chlorella are the greenish ones. Those are little pills. They also help a lot with colon cleansing and detoxification. One should keep in mind that it is estimated that around 60 to 80% of our immune system is maintained or repaired by the intestines. Is strengthened, the immune system. And that's why it's important to try to cleanse the intestines. And that's good with chlorella or spirulina. And of course what you're saying, zeolite and bentonite, they all help clean up the gut, cleanse the gut, pull out the toxins and yes, pull out the heavy metal. Already highly recommended. Another thing I've noticed since I've been doing the heavy metal detox smoothie is that my head has been rattling quite often, at least 4 times. Ah, that's good. It is obviously very good for the pineal gland as well. Pineal gland. Yes, it then reports by cracking or knocking. Gossip. As if a buckle like that, like a metal tensioner, popped open. Yes, since then I've seen more again. Hmm. Ah yes. So I can recommend. Yes, then of course the decalcification of the pineal gland would also be announced. But since the pineal gland is a really big topic, we're going to do an extra video about it. This is now specifically about the spiritual diet. So now you know exactly what we favor and how we can, should, and should detox in order to cleanse our system and raise our energy frequency. Yes, do I still have something on my smart list? We have now also mentioned some diet. There are of course many, many more. But these are the best, the best, the best. At least the ones like us, at least the ones that we are. Calm down, you have time. At least those are the we okay. At least those are the supplement. Outtakes. Yes, this time we bring in some outtakes. You did some good out. At least these are the dietary supplements that we use. And I used to do a lot more for detoxification and cleansing. But at the moment I really think spirulina and enteros gel and zeolite and chlorella are among the best and what's in the heavy metal detox smoothie. And are there any that come to mind spontaneously? What do you and soda, soda? But other than that, can you think of any other things you've done for detoxification? So with baking soda, I have to add that you have to be a bit careful not to take it around mealtime, because baking soda neutralizes stomach acid. So that would be unfavorable. So you have to wait 2 or 3 hours after eating before you pour baking soda, because otherwise you'll have digestive problems. And we don't want that. So that's the only thing you have to consider with baking soda. Otherwise you can actually always use baking soda. What I can say about detoxification is that you can also do fasting cures. You shouldn't get hardcore right away, but could start with smoothie fasting. That you drink 3 smoothies a day for a few days and then reduce it further and further down to 2 smoothies, then 1 smoothie and then with tea and broth or really just tea or something water. Water fasting is of course also very detoxifying and very cleansing. It's not for everyone. It was fun. I've done that a few times. I think you too. And it also helps with detoxification. So those are just our main points in terms of dietary supplements. Of course, there are many more dietary supplements that you can take that we have all tried once or several times. Yes, we have tried everything. But that's just a small cross-section of the most important and effective ones. And yes, those of you who would like to try it should always remember that with spirulina it should be 10 to 12 grams a day that you give yourself. Half a sachet for baking soda. And if you're brave, a whole sachet. They come in bag shapes. Well, it's called Kaiser Natron, a green package that you often get in drugstores and health food stores. Yes, and zeolite, bentonite, how much are popular there on a daily basis? 15 grams about. Yes, even 15 grams a day. Maybe somehow distributed throughout the day, like 2 or 3 times a day, exactly. But please remember to allow 2 hours before and after eating. Correct. The only things you should eat are spirulina and chlorella. Exactly. So the ones to eat at the same time in. If you want to do that with the detox smoothie and the celery juice, I'll just briefly describe how I do it. I drink my lemon juice in the morning. I squeeze a lemon and put it in a glass and put water on it and drink it. After about 20 minutes or after half an hour, my freshly squeezed celery juice comes with a slow juicer. And then again half an hour later the detox smoothie. Yes, and then 2 hours later I take enteros gel or zeolite or zebint, so that what has just been flushed into the intestines by the detoxification can also be drained and absorbed. That's it. A very good combination. In any case. And if you stick with it for a few months and then switch to raw food or an alkaline diet, I'd say you're fit as a fiddle afterwards. That was the word for Sunday. Goodbye and bye-bye. Goodbye. Bye-bye.